Welcome everyone. Before we start, I'd like to ask you to feel free to ask any questions you might have during the presentation. This presentation and all the links I will give you, you can find them on switch.nl/DrupalJam. I'll put a link to the recording also when it's available. So, my name is Björn Brala. I'm technical director at Swiss. I live in Leiden, in the Netherlands, with my three cats, my wife, and my daughter, all four. I've started developing for the web back in 2003, when frames were fine and Flash was cool. And I started using Drupal when 8 was in beta, because I thought the modernization of Drupal was a giant leap forward, and was worth my time. So, fast forward to now, I work as a technical director at Swiss. Swiss creates digital experiences that supports Drupal, Laravel, and multiple front-end frameworks. Our client base spans multiple sectors and sizes, so getting the communication right is essential in creating sustainable architectures. We create our converting websites in Drupal most of the time. Nowadays, in order to create a complete digital experience, you need to connect to multiple systems to make sure online transactions go smoothly. So integration of systems like a CRM or ERP or financial software streamline the workflow for the employees and the customer journey for the clients. We mostly use Laravel and Vue.js to create custom applications that solve specific business needs for our clients, but we always try to use the right tool for the job. So going forward from this architecture, we create a platform where we help our clients create an optimal digital experience. Experience aren't really limited to single websites anymore. You can have a normal Drupal website as your corporate site, SPAs to help your clients on the move, or native applications, or even APIs to let your clients create more value for your businesses. And we're not really using only computers anymore. Mobile, voice, IoT devices, VR, all are part of the online website. We combine these tools to create the optimal digital experience for our clients and their clients. So, I say stop the noise. We should stop talking about how we communicate and start talking about what we communicate. And this is where JSON API comes in. On the homepage of JSON API, they say, if you ever argued with your team about the way JSON responses should be formatted, JSON API can be your anti-bikeshedding tool. So you might think, bikeshedding? Sorry? So, back in the 50s, a guy named Parkinson made the argument that members of an organization give too much weight to trivial issues. So when approving the plans for a power plant, they talk most of the time about what color the bike shed should be. This eventually led to the term bike shedding, where we spend too much time discussing wrong things. I see this happen all the time. Getting interop right between multiple teams and the systems is hard, but a lot of time is wasted in talking about the way the systems communicate. So guys, stop talking about the color of your bike shed. Any color will do, really. We love our jobs. We love talking about architectures. We love talking about innovative solutions to problems. I mean, connecting multiple systems is fun. Discussing the structure of an API for a gazillion time is not so fun. So JSON API solves the problem by defining a generic format for all your API responses. No need to talk about structure or write a new API client for every single service. And we can go back to doing the things we love, and that's solving new problems. I'm going to start with a short introduction about JSON API and how it got into Drupal core. So JSON API was originally drafted by Yehuda Katz in May 2013. This guy is one of the creators of Ember.js, is a member of the Rust core team, was a member of Ruby on Rails and jQuery core team, and has a few more credentials. So in 2013, he extracted the first draft from the JSON transport, implicitly defined as Ember data rested at. The goal for that adapter was eliminate the need for ad hoc code per application to communicate with servers that communicate in a well-defined way. So in general, you should not require code to communicate with the server. In the next 2 years, getting the spec complete, and in 2015 the first 1.0 release was released. What I find awesome about this is not a spec that's crafted in the back room office of some company, but extracted from solving real world problems and iterating through those. I think that's the best kind of spec. The specification is only really viable when it's used. I mean, if you're the sole implementer of a specification, there's not so much to gain. There are quite a few companies that are already using the spec publicly, ignoring the fact that every up-to-date Drupal installation is a potential implementation. So Netflix have published an extremely fast JSON API serializer for Ruby, hinting at usage internally. Fitbit has exposed their friend's web API in JSON API, and an employee did a presentation on how JSON API helped Fitbit smoothing out inter-service communication internally. G2 Crowd, a site for software solutions used for the data API. The Apple Store Connect API, launched in 2018, uses it to help developers automate their development cycle. And currently, KFC UK is building a new site where all content will be loaded through JSON API from Drupal. So even the bigger companies are currently embracing JSON API as a way to solve communication and exposing public APIs. On the site of jsonapi.org, there are 150 client and server implementations available in about 20 different languages. So in regards to Drupal, this means that the client implementations can help you or partners to get the data into a wide range of languages and frameworks. Of all the server implementations, I must say that Drupal's implementation is the most complete implementation available right now. So, the Drupal JSON API module, a guy named Mathieu started in 2016 to make a contract module for JSON API. His username, I asked him, is AOItso. I would never thought that. And he released 1.0 in 2017. A year later, Wim Leers and Gabe Solis were put on the module by Akia to help getting the module ready for core. This work resulted in a 2.0 release in January, and this marked the move of the module to Drupal core. This March, the module was committed to Drupal core, and it now is released in Drupal 8.7. So, took a while, took some commits, took some releases, but in the end, it's pretty impressive how they managed to build the complete spec into Drupal in only 2.5 years. So, let's get to the good stuff. Let's talk about the specification. The JSON API uses basic HTTP for its communication. The HTTP method defines what the API will do with your request. The API response is in JSON with a specific header for a content type. This means JSON API is pretty easy to integrate in an existing hosting stack, because all your optimizations you might have made for caching or load balancing or other basic optimizations will also be applied to the API. So let's have a look at a basic example. Good enough. We call get to the articles with ID 1, and this will result in the article. Nothing more than that. The response is a simple JSON document with the information for that entity. So you have the structure type and ID to know what record it is, and you have an attributes property where all the attributes will be. You'll see the relationships for this entity in the relation tag. This contains basic the basic relation and a reference to that entity. So you only see the ID and the type, and a link to where you can get more information about that entity. Using the links in the documents, you can explore the other information that might be in this response. But this one really scratching the surface. There are quite a few features in JSON API which make it such a lovely spec to use. So next up are compound documents. They are defined as to reduce the number of HTTP requests, service may allow responses that include related resources along with the requested primary resources. Such responses are called compound documents. So that sounds pretty awesome, right? A compound document is a response which includes the data for all the relations for that entity. So for example, when requesting an article, you can get all the data for the author and perhaps even the comments on the document. This is also for a few reasons. Getting the full data of a resource you want to consume in one go is pretty unheard of, unless you're programming specific endpoints. And on the server side of things, caching and invalidating requests like this is easy peasy. So let's have a better look at a compound document. Here we have an article with ID 1, and in relationships you see comments with just that just refers to the type and ID. At the bottom you now have an included tag. Let's have a look what that is. In the included tag you'll see the same document as the main. And here you find the comment with ID 5 with the attributes related to it. Some things to note though. It might feel weird for the JSON to only refer to the related resource by an ID and a type, and including that data in another property later down the line. But imagine being an author. Multiple articles might refer to the same author. This way, the JSON API only sends the author once, which is pretty efficient. So when you start retrieving large lists of articles, the includes might get out of hand pretty fast. If you load 10 articles and with all the reference to taxonomy, users, comments, or more, your documents will get huge. So you don't always want everything. Sometimes you just need to relate an author or certain taxonomy should be kept on the server. In order to debload your request, you can specify what relations you want in the include parameter. So here you see I'm retrieving an article with only the author included. In the document, every other relation is now just referenced by the ID and type. This parameter is pretty flexible. If you need more than one include, so for example, the author and the comments, you can just comment separate them and put them in your request. This way, the author and the comments will come into your included tag. But that's not all. We can go deeper. Comments also have related authors. So you can include nested relations with these using a dot notation. So adding comments.author will include all the comments and all the authors that are related to those comments, all in the included tag below. This level of flexibility makes retrieving the correct information a breeze. as I said earlier, fetching data from JSON API, if you're fetching data from a JSON API, your requests can get large pretty fast. Especially when they include relationships, contain a lot of data. Most of the time, you don't really need every single bit of data, but you just want things like the author name or the common body and the common author. JSON API provides sparse field sets for this use case. So, you use sparse field sets with the fields parameter. The key of the parameter is the resource type, so here, fields, articles, and the value is or are the fields you might want to retrieve. So this way you can specify for every type of resource in your response what fields you want to retrieve from the API. So for here, this is articles, we select the title and body, and for people, we select name. Talked about fetching documents. We talked about slimming down the content of the documents. Now, let's have a look at filtering of collections. The spec says the filter query parameter is reserved for filtering down. Servers and clients should use this key for filtering operations. So, JSON API only says use the filter parameter. Enjoy. So, okay, that's fine, so let's try it again. Filtering in Drupal. The filter implementation of Drupal is extremely powerful, but this does mean there's a slight learning curve to get used to. So, simplest, most common filter is a key value filter. You just use the parameter filter, you tell us what field you want to filter on equals value. That's it. You can append any amount of filters in your request. Drupal supports two ways of writing filters. This is the short syntax, and but if you want more control, there's also what Drupal defines as the normal syntax. So here we're filtering on the field first name with the name Janice. If we look at the normal syntax, we split the path operator value to make them separate. We give each parameter a label, and tell it that we're giving it a condition. So the path is the field we're filtering on, the operator is, well, the operator to compare the field to the value, and the value is the value. The label is essential to group these three parameters, and you must be sure that those are unique. Otherwise, things will override each other and it will get messy. For a normal key value filter, this doesn't do much. Yeah, but it opens a plethora of possibilities later down the line. For example, this way we can have full control on the operator. So the filter system supports multiple operators, condition grouping to control conjunctions, so and, or, and paths to define what we're filtering. Let's have a closer look at these paths. The operator describes how we compare a value. Sure. We have quite a lot available. If you look at the source, we have everything you might need. We have the normal equals, we have greater or less than, we have string comparisons, and we have value in set, range comparisons, and null comparisons. So, for example, if I want to filter on the first name starting with a J, I just change the operator to start with, value to a J, and you'll be set. Every condition that compares to a single operator works this way. Set operator, set the value, good to go. Now if your operator compares to a single value, you need a way to send multiple values to the system. You do this by making the parameter an array. Let's try finding users for different names. So for this, we use the in operator, and we set the name we want to match as an array. So this would match all people with the first name of either Janice, John, or Jeff. This syntax works for everything that has needs more than one value. So, for example, the value in set and range. Next up, condition grouping. Consider the following question. Show me the users that have a job developer and have first or last name Smith. In order to get this working, we need a way to group first name is Smith or last name is Smith together a bit more quickly. For this, we need to create a condition group. The condition group is a set of conditions with a specified conjunction. This is such a group. The group starts with a label, which we use to refer to it later, and we tell our API that we're defining a group with a conjunction or. After defining the group, we can add conditions to this group. For this, we use the member of property and refer to the group we defined earlier. Every condition that's in this group will use the conjunction defined above to compare to each other. So, quick question. Who knows that notices something missing in this example? Sorry?
Operator.
Yes, the operator, exactly. The operator is missing. The thing is, the default operator is equals. So you don't need to write equals if you want to use it. There's quite a few of those little shortcuts hidden in Drupal. And you'll find these in the documentation on drupal.org. I'm not going to go through everything. So, hopefully you understand how grouping will help you to create the right filters. So we'll look at a few examples later on to help create some context. Next up, paths. In our examples, we see paths used to communicate the fields which we need to filter. So here, earlier we talked about includes. And I showed you that we use a dot notation to refer to a nested relation. Paths can do the same. So for example, we can have a user's career stored in a separate resource. This means if we want to filter on the name of the career, we need to refer to it as fieldCareer.name. That same technique is used for fields that might store subvalues. So for example, consider a phone field. It might also have a country code attached to it, or an address field might have an address line and locality. You can refer to it with the same dot notation. This is a lot of process. To give you a bit more feeling about how you would use this in the real world, I'd like to run through a few examples of the documentation. So, just get published notes. Filter on status as well. This is not very exciting. So get nodes created by the user n. So we filter on uid.name, which is a relation to the user, and the value should be admin. Here we do the string comparison, filtering nodes where title contains foo. So we filter, the key is the field, and here we use the operator in the short version. We say it should be contains, and we filter on the value of food. So you can use this for other filters also. Use the separate operator and value, and use a shortcut without a label. Last but not least, filtering by non-standard complex fields. For example, here we have a filter on the field address, and we want to filter on the locality of that field. So we use filterAddress.locality and give it a value. Same for another value for the field, it could be the address one. But now we're quite capable of selecting the right set of data and trimming down the data to something we need. But you might want to sort your documents in a more sane way. This could be as simple as sorting by created date, or it should be any parameters really. So that's what's simple. Sorting is done by using the sort parameter, sorting a field is done by using sort equals create. By default, the parameters are sorted ascending, so unless you want the oldest articles first, this is probably the easiest. In order to reverse the order of your sort, you just add a minus sign to it, which reverses the order, and now we get the newest record first. And you could, compile a list of latest articles. The sort parameter accepts multiple values separated by a comma. So to ask the API to order by author, the created date, we use author, comma, minus created. So this is basic sorting. Up until now, pretty much every parameter we see could be filled with the value of inside a relation. This is also true for sorting. For example, in Drupal, if you'd like to sort by the author name, you would use sort, it would be dot name, comma, create. It's a bit of a weird sorting, but this will fetch the related data as well by its username. Drupal also, since the parsing of the arguments is the same as for filtering and other things, you also have a normal syntax. Though I don't really see why you would ever use that, because it doesn't really give you any extra functionality. It's the shorts that the syntax gives. So next up, pagination. You really do need to limit your results to a sensible collection of results. This is the definition. Page query parameter is reserved for pagination. Servers and clients should use this key for pagination operations. I see a pattern here. So pagination in Drupal. Let's have a look at a basic example of a paginated response. There's a few things to note here. There are three pagination links in the links property. Self is the current URL, next will be the next page, and previous will be the previous page. There's also a page limit set to three, so that's why you see three results in the data. It's important to note that the existence of the links conveys information. So, for example, if the next doesn't exist, it's the last page. If the previous doesn't exist, it's the first page. And if none exists, it's the only page. So, the response does inform you as complete as it can about the state of the page. There's a few gotchas in relation to pagination. The maximum limit per page is 50. This is pretty random, but that's what was decided in the JSON API module with reasoning that it's harder to DDoS your API by querying uncached results and pulling down the website. There's no page count available in the response because, they didn't find a way to do that in an efficient manner. When you understand the structure of JSON API documents, creating and updating resources will be a breeze. It uses standard HTTP verbs to communicate the desired action of the request. So, parse for creating, patch for partial updating, and delete for deleting resources. Let's have a look at creating a resource in JSON API. You send a complete document to the same server through post, to the endpoint of the resource, and this document will look the same as you normally receive your document, but you can skip adding an ID. You should notice that the relations to other types are included directly in the payload, so you can set the relations right. The API responds with a 201 created, if all goes well, and the body of the response will contain the document you just created, only with the ID, if that was generated on the server. So So this helps you, if you're working client-side, to add all the information you need to the swiping tools, default values or fields or stuff like that. To update the resource, you set a patch request to a single resource. This overrides all the attributes specified in the paper. So it's quite important to note that any attribute that's not defined is left alone. If you want to fully replace a record, you have to define all attributes you want to override. If you want to remove the value of an attribute, you just set it to null or empty string, depends on what field we're looking at. Patch requests can also be used to update relations. Here we have an example with a few different relations. We have author, which is a 2-1 relation. Here, the request will set the related author to a person with the ID 1. The second one is a tags relation, which is a too-many relation. Important to note is that this dataset will replace all links to tags. So you might have 5 tags related. If you send this request, it will be only these 2. So this way you can also clear a relation. So for the comments, you have an empty array, which means every related comment is removed from this order. Sake of completing the CRUD, we also have delete. You send the delete to the endpoint for a single document, and the response code will tell you if it was okay. So, what did we learn today? This is about everything I want to tell you right now about the specification and how it works. So, we had a look at document structure with compound documents and relations and links. We had a good look at how we can limit data usage by using sparse field sets, includes, filters, and pagination. And we had a short look at how we can create and update documents through both batch and delete. So you should have a good overview on how JSON API can help you communicate efficiently between services. I love the structure, extreme consistency, and built-in flexibility of JSON API. It really tickles my developer's heart. This consistency makes it the perfect fit for Drupal. The way Drupal handles nodes, relations, and caching makes it that the data can slot into the spec perfectly, reflecting the data model beautifully in JSON. Since Drupal is now shipping with JSON API for every single site with 0 configuration, I feel this is the start of a new era where Drupal will gain more and more ground being the go-to headless CMS. Let's work together to stop the noise and use our combined forces to make JSON API everyone's smart default. Thank you. So, question. Are there questions of people here? Yeah.
I wonder, first, thank you for the talk.
Yeah.
I wonder how exceptions are handled. Is there also a spec for that?
Yeah, the JSON API spec has an error format where you send back information about what an error is and some meta information on why the error is. So you can also always inspect a document on the forum error key where there might be an explanation why things go wrong. I mean, you could get an HTTP code which says, well, this entity already exists, for example, but the more information about the error will be in the error document. The information is there. The spec is used in the documentation. You can find a little bit more information on how to parse that and get your information from there.
Thank you.
Good question. Yeah.
Authentication and
JSON API doesn't really do authentication, so you need to use something like, for example, simple OAuth to handle authentication. Would advise you to also use simple OAuth extras, since there are some extra ways to get the best brand for your user. And since JSON API now is in core, it integrates completely with the entity model. This means that permissions and roles are integrated in how the data comes to the user. So if a field is internal, or if you have no rights to a field or resource, you won't get data. One of the things that might be not optimal right now is the fact that it does an entity query to the data, gets the data, and loops through the results to do extra access checks. This means, this is one of the reasons why the limit is 50, because if you ask for like 5,000 documents and it's going to work through all the entities to see if you have access, that's going to be slow and be having the limit. So it integrates completely, and you don't really have to worry too much, really. That's about it. Thank you.
I have a question about the filter condition part.
Sure.
How far can the relationships of that go?
Well, endless. Yeah.
Okay,
yes.
There is no limit.
No, there's no limit. So you can just keep on going through the relation. Be wary though. Every single step in the relation will mean that everything from that relation will be started to be added to the includes,
okay.
Because it works through referring to the referred document in the specific, for example, comment. Yeah? So the request will be large. But caching is quite good, so it might be a good trade-off at some point.
And that includes, does it by default add everything you have added into your...
I think it does. It should.
Okay.
But it might... Not for Drupal, I'm not coming in so much.
Okay.
It should include everything for the data by default.
Yes.
The reasoning being that get your information without doing too much work, and then strip down the things you might not want to use.
Yes.
So by default, especially if you're developing for such an API, by default you have all the information you need. And then from there, when you're done and you're done developing, you can start optimizing and saying, well, I only really need this information or this data or this attribute. Yeah, you had a question.
Is it also integrated with a config entity? Like, can we fetch all node types with a JSON API?
Yes.
So, for example, to use it to create some headless admin?
I think one of the reasons they created JSON API, it's a part of the API First initiative, but they're also working on a separate admin application for Drupal. And this is one of the reasons that JSON API was created, to make sure that there is a good API exposing everything to that interface. So, yeah, that way you do need things.
Okay.
Yeah,
thanks.
Awesome. So are there any other questions? Ah, yes.
What about relation to the routes? For example, is JSON API a good fit in the sense of when really having headless frontend? Think about GraphQL, does that well? Is JSON API like now the good fit as the communication for your frontend headless?
I do feel that JSON API is a good fit. Things as routes, you do need. I do think you do need a separate module for that to get that working. I think there's some issues open also in that regard. But if you want to have a good comparison on how GraphQL and JSON API and perhaps the REST API of Drupal compare and what the pros and cons are, I want to refer to a blog post. Dries made not so long ago comparing the pros and cons of those three APIs, because I don't think I can explain it that good right now to you. rather refer to you. That I will make sure that the link to that blog post is online, what you probably already know about. If I look at your face.
I know the blog.
Any other questions? No? Okay. Thank you, everyone. Presentation, links, and more. swiss.ml/DrupalJam. If you want to know more when I talk about JSON API or perhaps organize a workshop, leave your email there. If you want to find me, I'll be in the foyer eating ice cream. Well, at least being next to the ice cream. So come talk, and we'll talk again. Thank you.